Welcome to my 1987 Olds Cutlass Cierra. This is the infamous Smacksmobile. This is the proof of concept vehicle for my Smack Booster design. First, a little bit about the engine. This is a 3.8 liter V6. It's got a custom cold air intake, custom fabbed headers, ceramic coated front to back. It's got a ceramic coated aluminum intake. You can see a nitrous system with nitrous and fuel and purge solenoids. And those are hand-fabricated nitrous and fuel rails that I designed myself. Valve covers are ceramic-coated. It's bored 30 over. Everything's fresh. New seals, new bearings. It's got a custom ground cam right from Competition Cam Factory. Around 250 horse without the nitrous. And the nitrous right now I have a 75 shot, but it'll take a 150 shot too. First thing I want to show you is the connection from the outlet of the booster into the intake manifold as close to the throttle body, which is right here, as reasonably possible. Mine is downstream of the mass airflow sensor on the correct side of the butterfly valve so that we are not applying vacuum to the Smack unit. Here's the unit installed. I do have an ammeter that I use on the road. But it's kind of a cheapy unit. It's just a quick reference guide for this demonstration. I've got a Fluke inductive ammeter, and I've also got a little voltmeter hooked up. You can see my quick connect electrical connections there. It's basically a GM alternator connection. The core of the cell can be quickly disconnected, unscrewed, and removed. Maintenance can be done to the electrolyte inside the canister. You got a little bit of a look here of the mount that I made and how it's situated within the engine compartment. As you can see, the bubbler is here. The output hose, as I've traced, goes right to the intake ducting as close to the throttle body as possible. And as far as wiring goes, 10 gauge. And everything is soldered and shrink-wrapped. Hopefully you guys can see this. Everything is soldered and shrink-wrapped. Nothing is crimped. Okay, even to the ammeter. Everything is soldered up. Solid. Here I've tapped off the top post, which is unused on this application. I purposefully got a battery, the side post and top post, so I could do these kind of experiments easily. So, you can see nice solid connections. That's a wing nut, but I tightened it with a wrench too. Here's your 30 amp circuit breaker. I prefer to use a circuit breaker rather than a fuse. It just seems to be cheaper that way instead of having to replace fuses. And underneath this 30 amp relay, all the power wires are soldered, not crimped, and everything's shrink wrapped, 10 gauge. Okay, so pretty much in a nutshell, that covers your basic Smack Booster insulation. The mileage results that I have are based on a large spread over various driving conditions this past winter, and I was able to record anywhere from 18 to 19 miles per gallon average. That's my base starting point, 18, 19 miles per gallon. I'm going to say 18.5 miles per gallon starting point. I'm going to start officially recording numbers for my particular unit. Try and match the 20% that I was receiving on my motorcycle that I still am receiving. The other part of the installation, as we pan around, some very important components to the Smackmobile, but I have a fuel pressure gauge and, very importantly, an air fuel ratio gauge. Now, these gauges are important in helping me monitor the health of my engine. The air-fuel ratio especially is going to tell me a generalized health of the fuel mixture and, indirectly telling me what kind of temperatures they're running. Ideally, like on my motorcycle, I'd have an EGT gauge. So, my switch for the booster, I mounted it down here. It's connected to ignition power. So the booster only comes on when I turn the motor on. I'd say, hook it up, an oil pressure sending unit, so that if the engine isn't running, the booster's not running, and you're not filling up your intake with hydroxy gas. Yeah, let's give this thing a crank. Let me show you. Let me show you what's going on as far as current. There's your air fuel happily pulsing away. My starting current, well, it's a little bit warm right now. It's been running. 16 amps. 13 or so, 13 and a half volts. There. There's your bubbler, bubbling away. Sending your gas right into the intake manifold. Okay. If you're going to smack your rig, optimize it too, because this battery can handle the load. I have nitrous heater blanket, fog lights, driving lights, amps, the Smacks booster running, and you know what? This battery can handle the load. That, combined with my high output alternator, this electrical system can handle anything I can throw at it. So, if you want to be successful, do what successful people do. And I'm telling you, I found success with this system. Alright people, welcome to my latest design. This is the BB Smack Gen 4. BB standing for Bob Boyce, because he is the original designer of this type of cell. So what we have here, it's 14 isolated series cells. 7 on each side of the applied power. So I have a positive center tap and outside negative tap. And between each one of the applied voltages, you have 7 individual cells. I've got 3/8 acrylic plates on the outside. This is these gaskets are PVC gaskets, okay? They're the stuff that you find on those refrigerator doors. The plates are 316L stainless steel. They're 22 gauge, 6x6. So this is a true isolated series design, not like some of the other dry cell designs where basically you have electrolyte flowing in and out, which means that across the top of the plates, you still have current jumping through the holes, okay? Each cell, each water pocket is 100% isolated from its neighbor. And I made a refill tube that refills each cell individually. This is why I'm able to do away with the equalization holes. We have done some efficiency tests. So far, 7 mmW at 53 degrees Celsius. So, and that's after 4 or 5 hours of running. That's the lowdown on the BB Smack Gen 4. So this video is about the installation of the Gen 4 BB Smack. This is a more efficient design. It's more compact. The quality of the hydroxy gas coming out of the unit is double that of what it used to be in my old designs. I've got 2 L-shaped brackets made out of cold rolled half-inch steel. Here's a picture of, here's a shot of one of the brackets. Shot of the other bracket. This is the first bubble. No air stone. Hydroxy just bubbles right through the output of the quarter-inch tube. The gas is initially scrubbed here, okay? So KOH or NOH is removed. Some of the moisture is removed. okay? And the gas continues along to the second bubbler, which further conditions with an air stone, making smaller bubbles, increasing the scrubbing action. As you can see, the water in this bubbler is crystal clear, and then the secondary bubbler acts to scrub any suspended electrolyte particles and also helps to condense any water vapor. Okay, no water in those lines at all. Okay, and you can see the injection point is before the mass airflow sensor. If you have an air box, drill a hole in the air box and put it before the air filter, so the air filter acts to diffuse the gas and more effectively mix it into the airstream, giving you a more uniform hydroxy air charge. Mechanically, there's your installation. Two bubblers, L brackets, fairly simple bolting mechanism, okay? Also, you see some red staining. The red staining is not on the stainless steel plate. It's in the PVC, the clear PVC. The staining came from the conditioning process, or the cleansing process, when iron was being pushed out of the surfaces of the stainless steel. When you cleanse the cell, you are going to push out impurities, mainly iron, and that's why it's red. The water has the characteristic yellow tinge. Got your new, the new 160,000 thick PVC. Here's the PEWM. So the terminals are clearly labeled, so the wiring is very easy. The PWM ensures that the cell won't draw over 24 amps. This has approximately 50 square inches of surface area between the two sides of the unit. So you can't draw any more than 24 amps through it, and this will ensure that happens. Without a PWM, the cell at 28% concentration will draw more than 24 amps once heated up to about 115, 120 degrees. I've gotten back from the Alternative Energy Partnership Conference that was held in Waldorf, Maryland. You guys just saw I posted a video, kind of did a quick run through of what was going on at the conference. Thanks, Larry. It was awesome. A lot of smart guys showed up. You know, we had one crafty dude there. We had Spodiotti, a Tesla hairpin and coil demonstration. And what you see before you is some notations and fuel receipts for the booster performance that I featured in my video during the conference. You see that I've now upgraded the Smacksmobile. I've tabulated all the results down, and I've kept track of all the receipts. I have two runs. Okay, I had the trip down and then the trip back home. Okay, so each leg of the trip is about 700 miles. And then on the way back, I did the same exact thing, except I turned the booster off. So the run back, there was no booster. The run to the event, there was a booster. When the booster was on, I used the FE device. When the booster was off, I did not use an FE device. Okay, so I took notes. And the trip down to Waldorf, Maryland took 722 miles. I consumed 49.19 gallons of fuel for an average mile per gallon of 14.68. Wow, how much does that suck, right? Oh, this Mac booster must really not be working, because you guys know that my pre-boosted numbers before I put the wet cell on was like 18.5-19 miles per gallon. Well, the news is I was towing the trailer with all my equipment on it down to the show. I was pulling some weight. That's why I got, you know, 14.68 miles per gallon, okay? And on the way back, I was towing the same trailer with the same weight. So, the way down, it was, both runs were basically late afternoon into the night. I drove nonstop. It's a 12, 13-hour trip. Our average speed, according to my GPS, which does calculate average moving speed, it was 55 miles per hour. And yes, I used cruise control, so that eliminates kind of the so-called driver error. I had the booster on at 24 amps, approximately 2 liters a minute with FE device set to the lower stoichiometric range. On my trip home, okay, 701 miles, 51.36 gallons of fuel consumed. Conditions were dry and cool, did not rain, towing same trailer. Average speed 55 miles an hour according to GPS using cruise control. No boost, no FE. Average mile per gallon, 13.65. Okay, so I did a percent delta calculation, and it comes out to 7.5% increase over non-boosted. So I got a 7.5% increase in fuel economy using my booster device.